Now am I on? There we go. Now am I on. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Brother Long and Sister Long are at General Conference right now. Our pastor is so important that he's required to be there. He doesn't have many choices anymore, so we get to share him with the nation. He holds a few important positions. And Sister Long gets to go on vacations with him. Amen. That's how that works. Right now, though, we're going to go for the Lord in prayer. Please remember the names that are going to be on the overhead. Remember your pastor and pastor's wife, they're traveling, and I know the Denny's are traveling as well. I got multiple text messages today. I feel like the flu is going around all over again. So there are a lot of people out sick. We'll pray for them. Let's pray for the Denny's. They're going to be, I think they're traveling home right now, so they're on the road. Our pastor and pastor's wife should be home soon. Dear Lord, I hope he gets home soon. It is not an easy job to fill his shoes. I promise you that. He is a very busy man. Let's pray for them. Remember the names on the overhead. If you have a need, come down. The ministry staff will pray for you. But let's go for the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you, Lord, for everything that you're already doing in this place tonight, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that. classes that are going to be dismissed are dismissed. I think you're all, unfortunately, stuck out here. You get to listen to me tonight. Obviously, like I said, Pastor Long is away at General Conference, enjoying himself. We have a great pastor, and because of that, we get to share him with the rest of the UPC. He is away. Board meetings. There's a lot of voting this year, so he was there for that. And they discussed Church in a Day, and he got recognition for that. Sister Long went with him. Kind of a little bit of a vacation for her, but believe it or not, a lot of people, and you don't really get to see it, but a lot of great preachers call our pastor bishop and look for him to advise. And we're honored that we have such a great pastor, that great men in this organization call our pastor bishop. So we are truly blessed. I texted him and I told him today, I told him, I don't know if I got it in me today. And he said, that's too bad. He said, because Josh preached last Thursday, Victor's at work. Brother Leggett can't be there. He said, so that's on you. He said, drink a cup of coffee, you'll be all right. So I sent him two messages and I said, I can preach. I said, or I can teach. And he said, well, whatever you feel like doing. And I told him, I said, well, I don't have it in me to full out preach. I said, so I'm going to teach for a little bit. And he read my lesson. He said, dear Lord, he said, I'm not the bishop yet. You're not taking over. And I guess that means I'm kind of going to be kind of a pastor's voice tonight. That's not my intention, I promise. But I sent him this, and he joked with me, and he said, dear Lord, boy, he said, I got at least 5 to 7 years left. He said, you should probably slow your roll. So I promise you, I'm not going to hold you long. But I am going to teach for a little bit tonight. I don't think I'm going to get too preachy at all. You may be seated. I'm not going to hold you long, but I think I'm going to teach for a little bit tonight. I'm going to try my hand at it. I feel like I do a pretty good job when I teach for the long lesson, but I don't really type one up myself and try it. My fiance tells me I'm a great teacher on Sunday nights, or on Sunday mornings, but she has to tell me that. Supposedly she's in love with me and is going to marry me, so. Dear God, pray for her. Tonight, I told you I'm not going to hold you long. My title today is somewhat simple. I'm going to teach a little bit. A lot of you haven't noticed, or at least you haven't told me. I'm down about 25 pounds. I dropped down from about 230 to I'm at right now 203 as of this morning. My dad's not here, so I can admit it, and I'm going to trust you all not to tell him. He was getting a little too close to my weight for comfort, so I decided I needed to drop down to where I needed to be. So that is why I have started running a little bit more. My knees don't hurt near as much. For some reason, I'm more comfortable at 203 than I was at 232. So my clothes aren't fitting right, and it's getting to be more expensive to be healthier. But regardless, my title tonight is going to be, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Start you off with a very famous quote from Jack Welch. It's a marathon, not a sprint. 10 years, 15 years. You've got to get up every day with a new idea, a new spin, and you're going to bring it to work every single day. That quote has kind of stuck with me as I've been running. My goal is to get somewhat to 2 to 3 miles every day. Normally around 2, 2.5, I decide that it's time to quit. The only problem is I still have half a mile to get back home, so I still have to get through that extra little half mile. But I'm sure if any of you have played any kind of sports growing up, at least when I was growing up, I feel like every single coach said the exact same thing to me. Stay the course. Give it your all. Nowadays, well, the youth group's out here, so they can correct me. Nowadays, they're saying, YOLO, you only live once. No? Okay, well, then they were when I was in college. So they were all saying, YOLO, you only live once. It's kind of today's motto. It's stay the course. Give it your all. Come on now. You can do better than that. Today's culture especially, I feel like we're bringing more tragedies and negatives into light more than we are any kind of positive aspect in life. The news today is terrible. Dear Lord, anytime you turn something on, it's almost like a sob story. You don't hear anything good. I was talking to Brother Petruzzi beforehand, and regardless where we stand on politics, I feel like the last 6 years, they have just destroyed whichever president has been in office. I don't remember the last time a news has said something good about our president. Regardless, when it was Obama, they never said anything good about him. And now that it's Trump, they never say anything good about him. I'm like, dear Lord, can we just say how stressful the job is and just give him one pat on the back? And nobody did it for Obama. Nobody's going to do it for Trump. And the next president, I don't feel like we're going to get any better. But today's society is focusing more on the negative. Athletes now are getting more praise for things they do off the field and off the court than what they're actually doing on them. Today's media is focusing more on a negative aspect in life. They're taking the lesson from our coaches of stay the course, give it your all. They're taking that more into a negative effect than they are really a positive effect. They're saying, well, give it my all. Well, I'm not good at this, so I'm going to give this my all. And they're not really taking it to the positive like coaches and mentors are trying to. They're taking it more in a negative effect. I saw all that to bring into light. I say all that to bring into light the more and more. Even before, we never bring the positive into light. I say that to bring up a few things that we have to start training ourselves, not only to bring positive things into light and to bring up a positive emotion, but we have to start training ourselves to almost get through this world, because unfortunately, I don't see any change coming. I don't see the news, the world around us start focusing more on the positive. And as a Christian, it's important that we're going to have to push ourselves through that. We're going to have to train ourselves. And personally, I could be wrong by this, but I cannot roll out of bed. When I started running, I could not roll out and just start running 3 miles still. I wish I could, but I had to train myself. I started off at a mile, and the mile was pretty easy. I could do that and wouldn't have any trouble. Mile and a half was pretty easy. That 2 mile part is getting easier. 2.5 is okay, I'm fine. 3 miles, I'm tired. I don't want to do anything the rest of the night. I'm done. However, I'm continuously training myself, trying to push farther. Show of hands here, how many people have ever ran a race competitively? About to say military members, every time we ran, it's competitive. I've ran, dear Lord, five or six, I can't remember, times for the military, once a year. And then I've done a Spartan race. And I'm telling you, some people take it serious, especially the Spartan races. Dear Lord, some people, I mean, me and David Petruzzi did it for fun. And we haven't done another one because we instantly figured out that, no. Like, we drove, Sister Petruzzi, it was a 3 or 4 hour drive to a race. And then we had to drive back in our muddy clothes. And we just decided, nah. Unless it's in Indianapolis, we ain't doing this again. We trained for it. We were at the gym every single day. We ran just about every single day, and we trained for it. And that 3.5 mile course was no joke. It took us about 1.5 hours to get 3.5 miles with obstacles and everything. So we just decided we weren't cut out for that. But through that, I've learned a few cheats. So I'm gonna share these cheats with you for training for marathons. These are the cheats that I've been taught in the military, and cheats that I very well do use when I run competitively, especially in the military. First, don't lead the pack in the beginning. You take off at the beginning at your top speed, I guarantee you're going to slow down a lot quicker. Stay right behind somebody. Find somebody that's going to run your pace and stay directly behind them. The wind resistance, they're going to get the wind resistance, and you're not going to get any of that wind resistance. You won't use as much of your muscle. Third, in through your nose, out through the mouth, out through your mouth. That way you don't cramp up. Breathe in a rhythm with your feet. For me, I take 4 breaths in and I take 2 breaths out. That's how I breathe. I breathe in a rhythm. Typically, I run with headphones, and that's the rhythm I choose to run to. Keep your head looking up towards the horizon. If you're looking up, naturally, you're going to run a little bit faster. When you look down at your feet, you start slowing down because you think you're going to trip. Keep your head up. You're not going to fall over. Last and most important, train. You have to train yourself. You have to train your legs. You have to train your knees to be able to put up with that punishment. Believe it or not, I have ran 26.2 miles one time. It's not something you can do just rolling out of bed and achieve. Your body has to be built up and be able to withstand the beating it's going to take. I said that correctly. The beating it's going to take. You can relay this into your Christian life, believe it or not. Training is a key aspect in your walk with God. Much like running a marathon, living for God is not going to be something you can just roll out of bed and instantly be good at. You're not going to be able to just to fall out of bed or climb out of the baptismal tank and instantly, we're all not going to be perfect Pentecostals, believe it or not. Most marathon runners today actually have started training at a very young age, because when you start early in life as a marathon runner or even as a sprinter, your body becomes more accustomed to the constant motion of training, the constant motion of running. Your knees almost have shocks in them because they're just used to the hurt. They're used to the pain because they started early in life. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Like the marathon runner, I can say this because I was raised in church. I think my sisters can agree with me. Because we were brought up in church, living for God just became part of our everyday life. I'm not saying it was 100% easy. We had our different struggles. We're brought up that we shouldn't do certain things in life. So by the time we're an adult, I don't want to say temptations are easier, but we sometimes don't see the same temptations being brought up in the church. Being brought up in the church, you get a little bit sheltered from them. That comes with having great parents. That comes with having a great church. We were somewhat sheltered from these. So I'm going to kind of bring it into this. How are we going to train for our marathon, for our walk with God? How do we get it into this? So I kind of based it off of what I do. Your base mileage. What your base mileage is going to consist of, I promise. If you just stick with me through all the running stuff, I'll get to where, how it ties into your walk with God. Your base mileage. Your base mileage is going to be built a weekly mileage over time. That's probably the most important part of my entire message tonight. Over time. Running 3 to 5 times per week. It's important to realize that that base mileage is what you start off your training with. And you build over time. Second part of your training is going to be the long run. You need to do a long run every 7 to 10 days so your body can adjust gradually to the long distance. If you start off running 3 or 4 miles, believe it or not, by day 2 or 3, your knees are going to be the size of a watermelon. You're not going to be able to continue it. So it's important that you gradually build. Third is speed. Once you get to the point to where you can run 2 miles, congratulations, running 2 miles in 20 minutes, it's probably not the best time. We're going to have to build our speed up. How we do that is practice intervals and tempo runs. What you're going to do is you're going to increase your muscle mass. You're going to increase the ability that you have in your legs to push your body, to excel your body even farther. The very last step is, hands down, my favorite of my training regimen. It's usually on a Saturday. Rest and recovery. Adequate rest helps prevent injuries and a mental burnout. If it was not for Saturdays, you can ask Amy. We did the walkathon on Saturday, and I was not used to running 3 miles on Saturday. It doesn't happen. I don't run on Saturdays. It's my day. If it's not my day off from work, I definitely don't run. If it is my day off, I may run a mile, but I don't run on Saturdays. That's my day of rest. That's the day I use my body to recover. Saturday was the walkathon. I ran 3 miles. I ran 2.5 miles. Normally, Brother Presswood, you can probably agree with me. Around that 2 mile point, your knees go numb. My knees didn't go numb at the 2 mile point. And I thought, you know what? I'll push to 2.5 and they'll go numb at 2.5. They didn't go numb at the 2.5 mile mark either. So by the end of my 2.5, I felt my knees just starting to harden up. And I stopped and I just told Amy and Amber, I said, I ain't running another mile. I said, I ain't got it in me. I said, my knees are going to be huge. And by the time we were at Chicago's Pizza in McCordsville, my knees had started to swell up just because I wasn't used to it. I wasn't taking my own training advice. And I just decided I didn't need to rest and recover. I was a Marine. I'll be all right. Unfortunately, I am still a man. Now that you know what you all thinking, we are Pentecostals. We don't run. We eat. That's what we are good at. That's why I got to 230 pounds, and I blame Pentecost. We're not runners. We're eaters. The only time we run is when they say it's the last call before the buffet line closes. So you're probably all sitting there saying, TJ, how in the world does this apply to my Christian life? Perfect. I'm glad you asked. I'm going to break it down to you Barney style. I'm going to break each step down to you. First, your base mileage. Remember, you need to build on that over time. Your base mileage is going to be, I'm going to attach that to your prayer life. You need to build your prayer life over time, praying 3 to 5 times per week. Your training and your walk with God is important that you begin with prayer. That's why as a child we are taught to pray over our food, to get us in the habit of praying. Anytime we get something, even as small as a plate of food, we are training children that, hey, this is a blessing from the Lord. You need to thank God for this. That's why we pray over our food, to get in the habit of prayer. As a church, let's just say we only pray when we have a scheduled prayer or when we're at church. If we just do that, we have our Sunday morning prayer before church happens. There's your one. First fruit prayer on Monday morning, there's 2 times. And Thursday before church, there's 3. So before you add any extra prayer into your life, you're already at 3 times per week. Already. And believe it or not, probably a lot of us don't know this. Now, I may step on some toes here. Once a month, each group has prayer. There's ladies' prayer. There's men's prayer. There's ladies' tea in the word. There's youth prayer. Each group has a Monday that they pray. So sometimes you get 4 once a week. That's what you get. So even during that time, there's your 3. If you don't pray at all during your time away from the church, just at church alone, you have your 3 times. That's something you can build on. It says 3 to 5 times, growing over time gradually. So after you get to that normal 3 times, believe it or not, you'll want to every morning to have a conversation with God, and you'll build that up. 3 to 5 times a week. After that, you're going to go into your long distance run. That right there alone, our long run. You should all be able to guess where I'm going with this. Sundays are our long runs. You got at least, at bare minimum, you're going to have 2.5 hours with the Lord. At least. It's important to be at church on Sundays. I said the long run needs to happen every 7 to 10 days. A week is 7 days. So by Sunday to Sunday, you need to have another long run. You need to be in church on Sundays. It's important. I think this may have been more for people that aren't here tonight than the people that are. But regardless, Sunday is how we build the resistance to whatever the world wants to throw our way on the daily, on a daily habit. Trust me, Fridays are the toughest days for me to run. Fridays, Saturdays, Wednesdays, before church, after we have that absence from church, if we don't have a normal prayer life, the longer we are away from the Lord, the easier it is for the devil to attack us. The easier it is for the enemy to get a hold of us. That's why it's important to have our base mileage set, that base prayer life set. That's why it's important to have that. And then we have our long run on Sundays. You have to gradually build your long distance. The first few Sundays is probably the toughest for new converts because they're just showing up. It's getting in the habit. I promise, eventually, it just becomes part of your morning routine. In our house, we woke up every Sunday at 7:30, growing up. There was 3 girls, plus my mother. If I wanted a warm shower, I woke up at 7. Otherwise, it was a cold shower. So I got to choose, sleep in or a warm shower. Me and Ashley are a lot alike. We slept in. We were all right in a cold shower. That or we learned that Saturday night, we could take one Saturday night late and have a warm shower and be okay for Sunday morning. So then we add a mile and begin to stand and clap during worship. This is when you're starting your long distance, you're starting to push a little bit more past that 3-mile mark, past that 2-mile mark. This is when we're going to start standing up. We're going to start clapping during worship. Then we actually start to worship. Congratulations, you're getting past that. That 3-mile mark is your comfortable zone. After that, then we get behind the preacher. Then on Sunday morning, when Brother Long rear backs and actually starts preaching to us and hammering on the pulpit, then we're actually getting up, amening, and we're getting there. Our long distance run is showing and improving. It's a natural progression. It's important. It's a natural progression. The next step in our workout and training ourselves in our walk with God is our speed work. I'm struggling tonight. I told you that I'm struggling. This is after we get our distance up. Once we've actually, you know, we're normal. We're used to getting behind the preacher. Worship is actual worship service and not just people singing songs. Our speed work. This is after our base mileage. This is where we get to just do this every once in a while. You can't do a speed tempo every single Sunday. Because if we get used to that, then we don't get our distance down. We're not going to get our distance running, so we have to get our speed work. This is meant to build strength and get faster. What do I mean by build strength? This is where we're going to get stronger in God, our stronger relationship in God. This is where when the enemy attacks us, his attacks are almost like, please, try harder next time. These are those kind of services that we completely shut down everything. Worship is the only thing that happens in the service, and Brother Long doesn't even get to preach. Those are occasional services. Those are our speed distance. We're going to worship more. We're going to worship a little bit harder because we've completely shut everything down and we just want to worship for a little bit. We're building our speed. When we have that, trust me, it's a workout when we have a shutdown service. But they can't happen every single day because we have to have a new and a fresh word from God. Worship makes us stronger, makes our battles easier because speed days are usually the toughest because we have to push ourselves into it. You have to get out of your comfort zone during those worship services because if we're all just standing there clapping or just, amen, yeah, hallelujah, Sister Long's almost done, yay. We're not pushing ourselves. We're not getting out of our comfort zone. We're not changing the schedule at all. But that's when we get stronger. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4 is a great scripture for this. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. I quoted that scripture for the sole purpose. It doesn't say when it's convenient or when you feel like it, but always. And guess what? When we're done rejoicing, we get to rejoice a little bit more. It's important. I preached on it not too long ago. Claim the victory. We have to come in expecting the victory. We have to come in worshiping for the victory. Even though we may not see it, we have to claim it. And then once we've gotten the victory and worship through the battle, congratulations. God delivered you from something. Let's worship because he delivered you. Your walk won't get easier without worship. You won't grow without worship. You can sit there and run and run and run. You can run 5 miles, and if it takes you an hour, that's not impressive. It's just not. If you're older, if you can run 5 miles in an hour, if you can run 5 miles in an hour, that's impressive. Brother Presswood, if I walked up to you and told you I ran 5 miles in an hour, he's going to look at me and probably say, did you walk? It's important. That's the time that my speed runs are, they're not going to be a distance. They're going to be a simple strength test. I'm going to push myself out of my comfort zone. I don't like running fast. It hurts more. I sweat more. I start to stink more. Amy doesn't like when I do my speed runs because I stink to high heaven. But I have to do them because I want to push myself. If you want a stronger relationship, you have to do your speed runs. You have to worship. That's why Brother Long is pushing so hard now on worship. Because we've gotten to the point now to where we've got our base mileage down. We're praying regularly. That's awesome. We've started our walk with God. We've gotten to the point to where we're averaging what we should on Sundays. We've gotten that down. Our long distance run is down. However, when we get to church on Sunday, we go through our routine. And we just go through the schedule. And by all means, God can still move in the schedule. However, I'm telling you, Brother Long is happiest when he does not have to preach. We have a great preacher when it comes to our pastor and a great teacher. But, man, he is happiest when he just gets to walk up here and say, dear Lord, I had a message, but there ain't no reason to. That's why it's important. Those are in the important part of our walk. We have to train ourselves. We have to get stronger in worship. The very last one, I'm going to hit hard on this one. And this, I'm pretty sure this is where my dad thought I was trying to be a pastor for a little bit. Rest and recovery. Fellowship. It's our big thing this year is discipleship. You can't disciple someone on Sundays and Thursdays. That can't be the only time you come out and disciple them. It's important that you take time out of your day on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday to spend time with people. Sister Hester, and I'm picking on you a lot, Grandma. I'm sorry, but I'm going to. Sister Hester went and spent a week with you at the cabin this summer. And dear Lord, I'm pretty sure that was the happiest I've ever seen Gigi in years. And Sister Hester was just amazed at the fact that we had this campground and she didn't know about it. But it was fellowship. That's what it was all about. It wasn't, I guarantee you, they're both older. But dear Lord, the fellowship, the friendship was what they wanted. It's what they were seeking. The fellowship was their rest and recovery. It's that time that they got to recover from all that. But yet they were still growing. They were still training. Adequate time to fellowship with other Pentecostals is one of the most important things when it comes to our training. Unfortunately, we can't just sit at home 7 nights a week and expect to get stronger in Christ. It doesn't happen. If you want to be a disciple, if you want to honor your pastor, dear Lord, you got to be a disciple. In order to disciple, you have to fellowship. I'll put all the blame on him. This applies to every single Pentecostal. I'm not just picking on people that have only been in church for a few years. I'm really hitting hard on people that have done this their entire life. I'll be honest with you. Fellowship is required to grow. Even if you've done it your entire life, fellowship is required when it comes to growth. That's why we have all of these groups, and that's why we do all of these things, to encourage fellowship. That's why we do everything like this. When we fellowship more, we seem to be more friendly. We seem to build relationships and start growing. That makes it tougher for new people to just get up and leave the church. Because when you have friends, then you think, man, they're my friend. When am I going to see them if I don't go to church? It makes it tougher for new people to just get up and leave. Because then they're worried about, well, they're my friend. I really want to see them. If that's what keeps them in church, awesome. Eventually, God will get his hands on them. If they come here solely because of your friendship, there's nothing wrong with that. God will get his hand on them eventually. One of these days, Brother Long will get the right sermon for them. And we'll get our claws in them and we'll sink them. But it's important that we fellowship and get new converts in. That's why we disciple. Fellowship. I have written in my notes here, stay on fellowship, drive it home. Fellowship, fellowship, fellowship. Living for God is not a sprint. We should make sure we are teaching the truth. Yes, we should. We should try to reach everybody that's lost quickly. Yes. We need to get them baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost quickly. Yes. Yes, that's all a sprint. Yes. But we cannot expect people to come out of the water and instantly be Pentecostals. I think that is honestly one of the biggest faults of the Pentecostals right now. I really do. We baptize people and instantly bring them out of the water and say, congratulations, everything you did wrong, you get to stop right now. I'm telling you, I didn't dip long. I dipped for about a year and a half. The first 2 months I stopped dipping was probably the toughest life point in my entire life. Because it's something I had daily. I went through a can of dip in probably 2 or 3 days. So it's something I always had in my mouth. I saw my sister snarl when I said that. It was a disgusting habit, but it was something I had, and I had to have. The first 2 months, because I just quit cold turkey. I knew good and well that if my father found, my father knew but never actually saw it. I know good and well if my father and my sister Ashley found out and actually saw me doing it, they'd probably beat the living daylights out of me. So I knew good and well when I came home I had to stop quit turkey or I wasn't going to be able to walk. It was probably the toughest 2 months of my entire life. I could quit that quickly because I've only done it a year and a half. So we can't instantly expect people to drop habits that they've done for years just because we baptized them. Yes, I do believe God will deliver people from addictions. Yes, I do. I don't think it's going to happen instantly, though. I just don't. I do believe that there's such a thing as personal convictions. Brother Hunt, true story, if you played golf, you were going to hell. If you went to Applebee's where they served alcohol, you were going to hell. Because Brother Hunt felt a personal conviction. He preached it, didn't he, Sister Penn? He preached it hard that if you did that, you were going to hell. That was a personal conviction from him. Thank the Lord, our pastor doesn't feel that way. I love to golf, and more importantly, I love Applebee's. We're Pentecostals. If we could only go to places that didn't serve alcohol, our choices would be Steak and Shake. And I can tear up a Frisco melt, but it gets old quick. It's important that we don't force people into dropping it instantly. Yes, they've been baptized. Yes, they've got the Holy Ghost. That's awesome. The sprint has started. Now the marathon begins. The purpose of the pathway class, believe it or not, is to welcome people into the church and get them comfortable with your pastor and with other people. That's why Brother Long insisted some people that have been in church a while were there. That's why he insisted that I teach one of those lessons, because it's important that we fellowship as a whole. That's why we focus so much on having great greeters. We have, I can say this because I've gone to churches all over this nation. We have probably the best greeting staff in the UPC. Hands down. We've gone to mega churches, 1,000 churches. I went to POA. If you don't know what POA, it is a huge church. Their greeting staff did the exact same things that our greeting staff did. And they have thousands. But they were just as friendly as ours. However, Brother Fuller wasn't there, so they didn't do as good of a job. That's the truth. It's important. We have a great greeting staff. As a church, we should mimic our greeting staff when it comes to how we greet people. It's important that just the greeters are not the only people that come up to new members. That's important. That's why Pastor Long pushes people to get involved. I taught it in the Pathway class. That's why it's important for you to find your ministry and to get into something. That's why it's important. You have to get involved. Because if you're involved and we get new people involved, that's a relationship. It's harder for them to leave because they feel needed. It's important that when we win new people to the Lord, we usher them into this like we would a child, slowly and friendly. You can't simply, the scripture says, I know, spare the rod, spoil the child. Yes, that is true. That comes to your actual children. We're not going to use that scripture for this. It's important that we bring them in as if they were children. We can't scream at every new person that comes into this church anytime they do something wrong, because they'll flee. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 and 5, it said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as the little child, the same is greatness in the kingdom of heaven. Here's the most important part. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. So if we want to be part of God and we want God inside of us, we have to receive new people as we would a little child. We have to welcome them in. We have to be friendly with them. We can't beat on somebody because they slipped up one time. Dear Lord, if I see somebody beating up on a new convert because they've slipped one, I'm going to tell Pastor Long and let him yank a knot in your tail. Because that's his job. We have to welcome them in slowly. Slip-ups are going to happen. I promise you, they're going to happen. It says, train up a child, not scream and beat them into submission. New converts will slowly get into it, I promise. But it's our job as disciples, as Pentecostals, to slowly welcome people in. Don't push every single belief a Pentecostal has on somebody the week they get baptized. It's called a personal conviction for a reason. Let God work in their life, and eventually God will give them that personal conviction. It's not our job to judge and play God. It's going to take time. Sometimes it takes longer than others. Patience is a virtue. My personal story, I didn't see anything wrong with shorts growing up. I didn't. For 16, 17 years, I told my dad, there ain't nothing wrong with shorts. And he says, that's fine. When you're 18, if you still feel that way, it's your personal conviction. I'll let you do whatever you want. Now, if I walk outside in shorts, now, when I'm running for the Marine Corps, I don't feel bad. If you women find those little tiny short shorts attractive, we need to have a prayer meeting. We need to have a serious prayer meeting, because that ain't right. But it's important. That's what I don't find that a personal conviction, because I'm training for something I signed up for. However, I feel weird walking out in a pair of basketball shorts. I just do. I feel weird. I don't like just walking out in a pair of shorts. I was raised, you don't wear shorts out in public. That's a personal conviction of mine. Am I telling you you're going to hell for wearing shorts? No, I am not. I am not telling you that. It's not my job. That's not my part. That's not where I'm supposed to be. However, if that's a personal conviction, then that's something you need to pray on. That's where your prayer, that's where your base mileage comes in. Anything that you feel personally convicted, that's something that they need to work through. If, as a disciple, if somebody comes to me and says, Brother TJ, I got a question for you, okay? And they ask about that, I will personally tell them my personal conviction. But I'm not going to say, daggone, you're right. You're going to go to hell for doing that. It's not what we're supposed to do. We're disciples. We disciple them. If you can't just tell somebody you're going to hell for doing that. If you can't back it up scripturally, you probably shouldn't tell them they're going to hell for it. Because that is judging, and believe it or not, I can quote y'all from scripture for judging. Personal convictions are key when we're welcoming new people in here. I'm preaching this. I'm going to be honest with you. Brother Long is away and has a blueprint for a new sanctuary. The problem is we have to outgrow this one. So it's time to outgrow this one so we can build a sanctuary that fits 350 people. I want the new building. That's the goal. So it's important that when we get new people and we take these aspects of these training, this discipleship, this, it's a marathon into our walk with them and into our discipleship with them. Living for God is not something that instantly changes overnight. It's important to help train and disciple people. I contact people that are great sprinters, that are great marathon runners, that are great runners, and I ask them, hey, this is what I'm doing. This is what I think I'm doing wrong. What can I do? And they give me advice. My gunnery sergeant, he calls me because I'm a better runner than him. He says, hey, this is what I'm doing. You got any advice? Normally, it's a, no, Gunny. I hate running. I'm the wrong guy to ask. But I'm a better runner than him. So they ask advice. So when somebody comes and asks you for advice and asks you, hey, I'm doing this, but I don't feel comfortable. Don't just tell them, well, you shouldn't feel comfortable. That's a sin. Sit down, have a conversation, disciple them, walk them through a training regimen. It's important that we do that. Start off trying to get people to make that base mileage. Get that prayer life down. That simple prayer life. Changes will happen when God is there daily. That's when those changes will happen. So you're going to have to go out of your way sometimes and say, hey, I'm going to First Fruits Prayer Monday. Do you need a ride? People are more likely, I'm a better runner when I run with somebody. I asked Skylar today. I said, hey, man, let's go run the canal. Because I'm a better runner when I run with somebody. I can't run the canal by myself. It's too far of a run. But I know if I have somebody with me, somebody I can talk to while I'm running, I can do it. So it's important that you find somebody. If you struggle getting here at First Fruits or you struggle just having a daily prayer life, find somebody that will meet with you to have that daily prayer life. You cannot skip the long run. The long run is important. You have to be here for Sunday morning's worship. You have to be here for Thursday night service. That's your long run. You have to be here. Even if Pastor Long isn't here. Dear Lord, I hope people are watching at home. We all need a fresh word from God weekly. We can't get by listening to Joel Osteen at our house. It's not enough. Your third one, I'm kind of summarizing them all. Your speed work. Brother Long's been pushing this hard lately. I'm telling you, me and him are getting on the same page either. He's starting to live a little looser, or I'm starting to live him right. One of the two is happening. Don't run up to a new convert and pull them out of the aisle. It's their first service. Dear Lord, we didn't run and grab you out of your first service. Lead by example. That's why we're pushing worship so hard. It's because when we get new people in, they can read the sign. They know we're crazy Pentecostals. They come in expecting a show. We're supposed to run the aisles. We're supposed to dance. We're supposed to shout. They know. People have heard of Pentecostals. So, dear Lord, at the bare minimum, let's give them what they came here for. Encourage them like you would a child. Perfect example. I've seen my nephews. They all do the same thing. All of them. They all worship the exact same way my mother and my father does. You want to know who mimics them the best? Hank. Hank mimics my mother to a T. It's impressive because they've watched Grammy do it, so they've watched by example and they've learned by example. So if you want to be a disciple, congratulations. You get to lead in worship by an example. That's why Brother Long has all the ministers up here instead of up here, because we're up here supposed to be leading by example. That's what they're supposed to be. It doesn't matter whether you're in the back or you're in the front. It's important to lead by example. Believe it or not, if everybody's up at the altar worshiping, if somebody's in their pew by themselves, they feel out of it and they'll naturally be drawn towards the front. It's a good thing during worship to get out of your pew and come up and crowd the altars. There's nothing wrong with that. I promise I'm trying to be done by 8:30. I'm wrapping it up. I promise. That's important. The speed work is important in our daily walk. Last, rest and relaxation. Fellowship. Fellowship. Fellowship, fellowship. We used to be, restaurants used to love us in this town because we were the Pentecostals that went out to eat every Sunday night and every Thursday and they knew they were going to get a big tip. And now Dear God, I feel like we're all on a diet or something. It's important to fellowship after church. But more importantly, it's important to fellowship outside of church. I'll give you a little hint. You want to make your pastor mad? Don't show up to plan events. I can tell you that as a fact. The way to upset your pastor is when we plan fellowships, don't show up. That hurts. You want to get your pastor good? That hurts your pastor more than anything. Because then we're not growing a relationship with each other. We're a family. Families get together more than once a week. Families that have a household of people, they usually eat dinner together every single night. I'm not telling you need to fellowship with everybody every single night. Dear Lord, if you guys call me every single night to fellowship, I need a little bit of time by myself. But it's important to fellowship. If you have a day off, it's important to fellowship. That's why we have these events. That's why the youth group is the way they are. They all hang out together. That's not a compliment that that's the way they are. It's not meant to be that way. Dear Lord, some of them are pretty weird. I love you guys. Some of you are pretty weird. Yes, David, you are the weird one. It's important. They fellowship together. And believe it or not, they all have each other's cell phone numbers. And yes, they're young kids, so they're more active. They can do more. Dear Lord, most of them don't drive, and they fellowship more than most of us. Because they like each other. They've grown a relationship. It's tougher for them to leave church because they have friends here. It's tougher for new people to leave when they have friends here. Make it harder on people to leave because we fellowship. I got 5 more minutes. I'm going to push fellowship for a little bit. It's important that we fellowship with each other. Go out to eat. McDonald's has a dollar menu. If you're poor, get a Coke. More importantly, water's free. That's the truth. Water's free. Growing up, I'm not kidding you. We would go to Grand Bowley's, and I don't remember the last time we didn't go to Grand Bowley's on a Thursday night growing up. I bummed a ride off Zane, Josh, because my sister Ashley and Amanda didn't want to take their little brother out. So I bummed a ride off those two. And they, every Thursday night, Zane or Josh took me home. Every single Thursday. Because it was just one of the things. Hey, he's the pastor's son, dear Lord. I probably was the annoying pastor's kid. That was probably my role. But I had a role in the group, and that I had to fill. Regardless, we fellowshipped. Because of that fellowship, the waitress at Grand Bowley's still have Zane and Cassie's phone number. They grew a relationship. One day, she's going to start coming to church because we built a relationship with them. Selfie September is meant for you to get your name out there and for us to take pictures with people, because if we go to these things, these places every single week and start asking people to take selfies with us, eventually they'll remember us. Aren't you that person that asked me to take a selfie with you? Yes, I am. What was that about again? You're inviting them to church. It's a conversation starter. That's what it's meant for. Magically, Selfie September has a better outcome when you go do it as a group. If for no other reason, go out and do Selfie September with a group of people. True story. This Monday, one of these days, there was a group of us that played Pokemon Go, and we went out to Fortville and played Pokemon Go. Dear Lord, yes, I know, Pokemon, yes. We went and played Pokemon Go, but it was fellowship. It was fellowship. Now, granted, it was all of us that were in church and have been in church most of our life, but it was fellowship. We took time out of our week to fellowship. I'm going to keep hitting this hard because I can't express how hard it is to fellowship, how important it is to fellowship. When we get a new convert, it's important that we invite them to the events. Just because it's their first Sunday, it doesn't matter. Fellowship, fellowship, fellowship. It does us no good if the only people that fellowship and come to new events are the new people from the church. Because then they're not growing a relationship with anybody else but the new people from the church. Because those people aren't concreted into this. They're not stuck into this. They don't have a drive to come to this. That's why it's important as new converts, we welcome them in. That's why we need to be at all the fellowship meetings. We cannot have every new person at fellowship by themselves. Because then the conversation will come up. Hey, where's so-and-so? Where are they at? Where's this person at? That's why we fellowship with each other. That's why we have these planned events. Fellowship. Fellowship is a key part of discipleship. I'm going to throw Pastor Long under the bus again. You want to make your pastor happy, you need to fellowship. Because he wants you to be a disciple. So therefore, if you want to be a disciple, you get to fellowship. Fellowship is important in your training method. That's why I taught this, not just to get the fellowship key out. But remember, your base mileage, your prayer life's important. You need to start that off. I'm closing. Let's everybody stand. I'm not going to do an altar call. Like I said, I'm teaching tonight. I didn't think I was preaching. Your base mileage, your prayer life's important. You need to start your week off with prayer 3 to 5 times a week. It's important. If you can only do it before service, there's 3 times. The long run, Sundays and Thursdays are your long run day. It's when you get to come here and either A, listen to Brother Long, or B, listen to Brother Josh or Brother Victor, or at the very worst, you get to listen to me. But the long run's important. Your speed work. Dear Lord, let's shut Brother Long down one Sunday. Amen. Let's just shut him down and worship for a little bit. I guarantee you he won't be mad because he had to study for an entire week to get ready for a sermon. He won't be mad at you. Rest and recovery. Fellowship with each other. It's important. That's how we're going to grow our relationship, and that's how we're going to grow. We have a great group. Every group has a great leader and somebody Brother Long trusts and believes in. Fellowship with each other. Dear Lord, go out to eat with somebody. We're Pentecostals. We like to eat. It's what we're good at. General conference is going on right now. The city of Louisville's restaurants are making a killing. They're staying open later because the Pentecostals are in town. We like to eat. If all you're doing is going out to eat, dear Lord, go out and eat. Fellowship is key to discipleship. Amen. I promise you, I'm done. I'm not going to hit on fellowship anymore. Let's close with prayer. Can we do that? I don't think I've stepped on anybody's toes too hard. If I have, dear Lord, maybe they need stepped on. Brother Long approved this message, so therefore I won't be in trouble when he gets home. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for everything that you've done tonight, God. Lord, thank you for the message that you've had tonight, God. Lord, teach everybody, Lord, to be able to go out and fellowship, Lord. Lord, drive me, God, to be a better disciple. Drive me to fellowship, Jesus, Lord. Lord, help me be a better disciple, Jesus, Lord. Help me welcome new people in, God, Lord. Help me with growth, Lord. Jesus, God, Lord, you are so worthy, God, in Jesus' name. Jesus. I hope I didn't offend anybody. I really don't. But I feel like it's time to grow. We're a great church. This is our city. It's not the church across the track. It's not their city. We're the Church of Lawrence. It's our job to reach this city. The city's not shrinking. It's getting bigger. We need to get bigger with the city. Let's get out there and reach people. Let's disciple people. If you have to challenge yourself, challenge yourself. But let's grow. Real quick announcements. Let me not forget any of these. Remember, Monday. First, we have service at Sunday at 10 a.m. And then worship at 11. Sunday school at 10, and then we start worship at 11. Amen? Amen? Not Sunday service, worship at 11. Remember, this coming Monday is going to be the first Monday of October. So, First Fruits is moved. It's not going to be 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. It's going to be 7 to 8. That needs to be our base mileage. We need to pray at least 3 times a week. If you can pray more, you should pray more. If you feel like you need to pray more, you should pray more. That's a personal conviction. Remember, October 6th at 4:30 is the Harper's wedding. They are our church family. Let's fellowship and celebrate with them. It's important because we're going to disciple people. They're going to become disciple makers, and then they're going to disciple people. Let's welcome them into this church. Jordan Harper's been coming here, but Anna hasn't. Dear Lord, let's fellowship with them. Let's get to know them. Amen? Amen. All right, there we go. And then after that, Thursday, we have service here. Brother Long will be back on Sunday. You won't have to listen to me preach again. Last Thursday, you got spoiled. Josh got to preach for you. And Brother Long, we had an evangelist on Sunday. And then you got stuck with me. So you got to climb up and then straight drop down. It's how that normally works. But fellowship, it's important. Dear Lord, walk up to somebody and at least talk to them for 5 minutes before you leave. Can we do that? God bless the greatest church in the whole wide world. You are dismissed.